also used in snowmobiles. For example, when you want to work at extremely low temperatures, it's a two-stroke engine which can work because of the simple lubrication system that it has got. We know that they are also used in small gensets, then in water scooters, then also in marine outboard motors. For example, the speed boats or the recreational boats, all of them use two-stroke engines. They are multi-cylinder two-stroke engines. On the other side, you also have two-stroke engines which are very large, like the large marine diesel engines. The diesel engines which power big ships, they are all two-stroke engines. And so you have two-stroke engines on two ends, the small engines and the very large engines. These very large engines are really large. For example, the bore and stroke of a really large engine could be something like, the bore could be about 1.5 meters, and the stroke could be some 2.5 meters. So something like that. They are also two-stroke engines. And on the other hand, you can also have toy planes and cars, like toy plane engines, where the bore could be just about 1 centimeter, or even less than 1 centimeter, and the stroke could be less than 1 centimeter. So you have two ends, but these two ends of the two-stroke engine are not similar. The small engines are all spark ignition engines. The large engines are all diesel engines. We also have two-stroke engines in, for example, the sprayers and things like that, where the user mounts the engine on his back and uses a sprayer to spray pesticides. So they are also used two-stroke engines. So there are many applications where two-stroke engines are used. And if you see, only one of these, which is scooters and motorcycles, is an automotive application. All the others are non-automotive applications. So what we can see from here is that the two-stroke engines will be there in all these applications. They may go in automotive applications, that too in the bigger automotive applications like motorcycles and scooters, but they'll still stay in mopeds and they'll stay in all the other applications. So it is useful to study about the two-stroke engine because there's a lot that can be done to improve a two-stroke engine. So coming to the working of a two-stroke engine, I know that you all know how a two-stroke engine works, so I'm not going to dwell upon this for a very long time. If you look at the working of a two-stroke engine, you know that the top and the bottom portions of the engine are being used. For example, you will use the top portion, which we call as the combustion chamber, and you also use the bottom portion, which is called as the crankcase. So both the top and the bottom portion of the engine would be used, and the air fuel mixture actually gets into the bottom portion. It gets into the bottom portion and then it is supplied to the top portion through the ports. So we call a two-stroke engine as a double acting engine. As we saw, both the top and bottom sides are used, so it's a double acting engine. And so we see that the engine is compact. So as you do something on the top of the piston, you do something else at the bottom of the piston. For example, if you are doing compression on the top of the piston, you're doing suction at the bottom of the piston. So four strokes of a four-stroke engine come in two strokes of a two-stroke engine. So every revolution we get a power stroke. And the point to note here is that the fresh fuel air mixture gets into the intake, which may be controlled by a valve, which may be controlled by the piston, goes into the crankcase, and then from the crankcase it is pumped into the cylinder or the top portion of the piston, where it undergoes combustion and all that. So there is a big path through which the mixture has to travel in a two-stroke engine. It has to go to the crankcase and then come to the top. This is what we see here. Now we'll proceed further and see certain important terms related to two-stroke engine. The first term which is related to two-stroke engine is called scavenging. Now what is called as scavenging? Now in a two-stroke engine, the fresh charge that comes from the bottom has to first enter and push the exhaust out. So what we do is the exhaust port, as we see here, and the piston moves down, first opens. And when the exhaust port opens, the exhaust gases rush out and the fresh charge then comes inside when the transfer port opens. So we call this port as a transfer port and this port as an exhaust port. So the fresh charge comes through the transfer port and pushes the exhaust out through the exhaust port. So during this process, we see what is called as scavenging. So the process of filling the cylinder with fresh charge is called scavenging. So during the scavenging process, several things happen. The first thing which happens is the exhaust goes out. And this goes out because of a pressure difference. And there is a pressure difference between the gas inside the cylinder and the atmosphere. So when the exhaust port opens, the exhaust gases rush out. And we call this as blowdown. We call this as a blowdown process. And after that, the exhaust does not go out on its own because the pressure inside the cylinder falls. And then the fresh charge which comes from the bottom pushes the exhaust out. And we see fresh charge pushing the exhaust. So these two processes are called scavenging. So the exhaust going out on its own and the fresh air coming behind the exhaust and pushing the exhaust out, these two processes together are called scavenging. And during this process, what we actually want is to fill the cylinder with fresh charge and not lose any fresh charge. We want to fill the cylinder with fresh charge and we do not want to lose any fresh charge. This is what we want to have. So this is what we call as good scavenging. Now good scavenging is got by a proper design of the ports. Now we have another problem called charge dilution. So if you look at the cylinder contents after the scavenging is done, you will not only have fresh charge but also exhaust, and we call this exhaust as a residual exhaust. So the charge is diluted. So we have what is called as a diluted charge. So this diluted charge does not burn properly. So you need to have a mixture which is rich. So we need to have a rich mixture. For combustion. So the point I want to make here is that during the scavenging process, you may not fully remove all the exhaust from the cylinder. So some exhaust will be retained in the cylinder. And this retained exhaust will mix with the fresh charge and you have what is called as a diluted fresh charge, and this diluted fresh charge does not burn well, and this diluted fresh charge, if it has to burn well, you have to use a rich mixture. And when I say rich mixture, it could be even richer than stoichiometric. Now if you look at gasoline, the stoichiometric air fuel ratio would be something like 14.5:1, is air is to fuel, it will be about 14.5:1 for gasoline. But in the case of a two-stroke engine, we may want to go very rich. We may even go up to about 12:1. That is 12 parts of air for one part of fuel. Instead of 14.5 parts of air for one part of fuel, that means you are going to run the engine rich. And if you do not run the engine rich, it will not, we will not be able to support combustion in a diluted environment. This is one of the problems in a two-stroke engine. So we now saw scavenging. We also saw charge dilution. So, and charge dilution is a result of poor scavenging. So if you have very good scavenging, you will not have charge dilution. All the exhaust would have gone out and the fresh charge would have been retained inside. We also have another problem which is called as short circuiting. Short circuiting is bypassing of the fresh charge. So the fresh charge comes into the cylinder, simply bypasses. So what you do is, if you have this cylinder and if you allow fresh charge, the exhaust is supposed to go out of the cylinder, but what happens is some of this fresh charge also goes out. So this we call as short circuiting of the fresh charge, which means that if you put some fuel into the engine, some of the fuel is directly going to go out to the, through the exhaust port. So this brings in another problem, and this problem means that the efficiency, which I will use the symbol eta for efficiency, efficiency thermal is low because we lose fuel. So fuel is lost through the exhaust port. Since fuel is lost through the exhaust port, your efficiency in a two-stroke engine is going to be low. So we saw different problems in the two-stroke engine. The first one was the scavenging related problems. The first one was charge dilution, that is you retain some exhaust gases which did not allow the fresh charge to burn. And you also lost some fresh charge which went out through the exhaust, which meant that you lost some fuel. So these are the two problems in a two-stroke engine, and those two problems mean that the performance of a two-stroke engine will be poor. It will not be as good as a four-stroke engine. Now we have several terms which we come across in a two-stroke engine. I will define these terms because we will use these terms very frequently. Now looking at scavenging, we need to define these terms. The first term which we define is called delivery ratio. Delivery ratio is something like volumetric efficiency. Something like volumetric efficiency of a four-stroke engine. It is actually written as mass delivered by reference mass. This is what we call as delivery ratio. That is, in a two-stroke engine, the mass of fresh fuel air mixture that is actually delivered to the engine divided by the ideal mass that you should have delivered. that you should have delivered. This mass that you actually deliver is actually measured. This you can measure. The reference mass is what you should have delivered under ideal conditions. What we should have delivered under ideal conditions is the displacement volume multiplied by a density. That is, you should have put displacement volume, amount of charge into the cylinder, and you should have put it at the density of the charge. And for density, I'll use ambient density. So you are taking charge from the atmosphere. So the relevant density, in fact, sometimes people use even the density of the air fuel mixture. But many times with textbooks we refer to density of the ambient itself. So we should be able to fill the cylinder with charge which is at ambient density, and the volume that you should be able to put into the cylinder is the displacement volume. That becomes the denominator, and what comes on the denominator is what you actually deliver. In a four stroke engine, this same term is called volumetric efficiency. In a two stroke engine, we call it delivery ratio. Now the delivery ratio in a two stroke engine is extremely low. In fact, the maximum delivery ratio, L max, will be about 0.7 to 0.8 only. It will be only about 0.7 to 0.8. That means you are going to deliver only 80% of the charge that you could have ideally delivered, which itself means that you are not fully filling the cylinder properly. That means there will be some space which will be occupied by exhaust gases. So this is the first term. If you have a higher delivery ratio, which it automatically means that you will have higher power outputs. You put more fresh charge, and you will also be able to drive the exhaust properly. So higher delivery ratios are preferred. The next term that we come across is scavenging efficiency. Scavenging efficiency is how well you have pushed the exhaust out. Now efficiency scavenging is nothing but the mass of fresh charge that is retained. You send some fresh charge into the cylinder, some of it was retained, some of it went out. The mass that was retained is put on the numerator, and total cylinder mass is put on the denominator. That is, you have full cylinder. This full cylinder contains some mass, out of which what is the fresh charge mass that you retained is the numerator. So this is called as scavenging efficiency. So this is another term which we come across in two-stroke engines. If this scavenging efficiency is good, that means inside the cylinder you have mostly fresh charge. If the scavenging efficiency is bad, it means that inside the cylinder you have a lot of exhaust. So this is another term which is important. Another term which is important is called trapping efficiency. It is the mass of the fresh charge that is retained by mass delivered. That is, you have fresh charge inside the cylinder, you send some fresh charge into the cylinder from the crankcase, and some of it has been retained, and that comes on the numerator. And on the denominator, you put what has been delivered. So what does this signify? If this value is very high, it means that whatever you have supplied is retained. Suppose this value becomes 1, then it means that mass retained and mass supplied are, mass delivered are the same. So if mass retained and mass delivered are the same, that means nothing was short-circuited. So this gives an indication of short-circuiting efficiency. If this value is high, it means there is no short-circuiting. So scavenging efficiency is high means you have very pure charge inside. That is, you have more of the retained charge in the total mass of the charge. If trapping efficiency is high, means you do not lose any charge through the exhaust port. So both the scavenging efficiency and trapping efficiency have to be high for a two-stroke engine. Is it clear? This is what we write from here. Purity is like scavenging efficiency. It tells how pure your charge is. Now let us look at the next aspect of a two-stroke. I am slowly giving you some introduction. Later on, we'll put these things together. Now this is the PV diagram of a two-stroke engine. If you look at the left hand side, you have the PV diagram of a two stroke engine. On the right hand side, you have the PV diagram of a four stroke engine. You have already been exposed to PV diagrams. Now if you look at the two stroke engine, the thing which is to be noted here is that you don't have the so called pumping loop. This loop is called the pumping loop in a four stroke engine, where you do the suction and exhaust strokes. During the suction stroke, the pressure in the cylinder is below atmospheric pressure. During the exhaust stroke, the pressure in the cylinder is above atmospheric pressure, and that's why you got that loop. Whereas in a two-stroke engine, you don't have that loop at all. In a two-stroke engine, you just have the pressure diagram only on the cylinder side. You have another pressure diagram on the crankcase side. So these two pressure diagrams are different, and what has been shown here is only on the cylinder side. So on the cylinder side, if I have to trace this pressure diagram, this is the expansion process. We will go from the expansion. So the piston is moving down. The piston is moving down from the top dead center to the bottom dead center. Expansion occurs, and at some point the exhaust port opens. So if you have to go to the previous figure, which we first saw, as the piston moves from the top dead center to the bottom dead center, the exhaust port opens at some point. And when the exhaust port opens, the exhaust gases will rush out, and the pressure in the cylinder will suddenly fall. And this we call as the blowdown process, which is what is shown here. So at this exhaust port opening point, the pressure suddenly falls, because when the exhaust port opens, the gases rush out. And the pressure falls, and after some time, the inlet port opens. And when the inlet port opens, the fresh charge from the crankcase will start entering into the cylinder. So between this exhaust opening point and inlet opening point, we call this as blowdown. So this is a phase where the exhaust opens. I'm sorry, this is continuously shifting. I'm not able to stop. So when the exhaust port opens, there's a rush of exhaust from the cylinder, pressure falls, and then after some time the pressure becomes equal to crankcase pressure, and that time the inlet port opens. And when the inlet port opens, the fresh charge from the crankcase comes into the cylinder. So this is inlet port opening, this is exhaust port opening, and the piston again closes the inlet port at this point and closes the exhaust port at this point. So when the piston moves down, it first opens the exhaust port. When it moves further, it opens the intake port. It goes to bottom dead center. When it comes up, it first closes the intake port and then closes the exhaust port. So that's what we see here. Exhaust opens, inlet opens, inlet closes, exhaust closes. And actual compression actually starts here. Compression actually starts at this point. So it is only here that we start compressing. The point I want to make here is, in a 4-stroke engine, we start compressing right from bottom dead center. In a 2-stroke engine, we do not start compressing from bottom dead center. We start compressing, we can start compressing only after the exhaust port is closed, which means that the compression starts here and ends at top dead center. So this I will call as the effective compression stroke. So you're not really compressing from bottom dead center. So the effective compression stroke is smaller than the actual stroke. The actual stroke is from BDC to TDC, but the compression stroke effectively is from exhaust port closing to top dead center, which is smaller. Similarly, the actual expansion stroke is also smaller. So this is actual expansion and compression stroke. So this is the actual expansion and compression stroke. This means that the engine is not going to expand your gases fully. It's only partly expanding the gases. So this also means that the efficiency of a 2-stroke engine will be low. So you can say now that the compression ratio of a 2-stroke will be lower than the compression ratio geometric. That is the geometric compression ratio. What do you mean by geometric compression ratio? It is volume at BDC by volume at TDC. The volume at BDC divided by volume at TDC is the compression ratio. But that is not the compression ratio in a 2-stroke engine. It is different, because compression starts only at the exhaust port closing point. It doesn't start from bottom dead center. So the volume at BDC is equivalent to volume at exhaust port closing point, which means that the effective compression ratio in a 2-stroke engine will be less than the geometric compression ratio. And this means that the efficiency of a 2-stroke engine thermodynamically itself will be lower. So if you take a 2-stroke engine whose compression ratio is something like 8 geometric, its actual compression ratio may be only about 7 or 6, which means that the engine would automatically develop lesser efficiencies. So this is one point to note. Now this summarizes the whole thing. Now we see the port timing diagram of a 2-stroke engine. The piston is at top dead center. Now let us trace from the point where the piston is at top dead center. The piston moves from top dead center to the bottom dead center. And at some point, when it moves down, the exhaust port opens. So we see EO. EO is exhaust port opening point. TO is transfer port opening point. Transfer port is the same as inlet port. Inlet port and transfer port are the same. So when the transfer port opens, you have fresh charge coming inside. When the exhaust port opens, you have high pressure gases going out. So this region is called blowdown. So after this blowdown, you have inlet occurring, and inlet starts from here and ends up to transfer port closing point. So this is the reason, this is the time during which you can have fresh charge coming from the crankcase into the cylinder. After this, the transfer port first closes, because the piston closes the transfer port first, and then the exhaust port closes. This region between the exhaust port closing and transfer port closing is something which you do not want, because when the transfer port closes, if the piston is moving up to close the exhaust port, whatever charge was taken into the cylinder would go out. So we do not want the exhaust port to close after the transfer port. We would like the exhaust port and the transfer port to close exactly the same point, or maybe we even want to close the exhaust port before the transfer port closes. But this is not possible in a normal two-stroke engine because of the piston being used for closing and opening the ports. So this is a defect in a two-stroke engine. And this defect occurs only in small two-stroke engines. It doesn't occur in big two-stroke engines where you can have valves. So in small two-stroke engines, it's a problem. So the problem is that you are not able to close the port early. Now the other problem is, if you look at the inlet opening, this is what happens at the bottom of the cylinder. So when the piston moves up, the bottom portion of the piston opens a crankcase, and fresh air from the atmosphere gets into the crankcase. And that is opened when the piston moves almost near top dead center. So the inlet port opens somewhere here and closes almost at the same time after top dead center. So this is the region the fresh charge can enter into the crankcase. So in this portion, the fresh charge can enter into the crankcase. And you can see here that when the piston moves from bottom dead center to top dead center, below the crankcase, the volume will be increasing. So in this region, volume is increasing, but in this region, volume is decreasing. So when volume is decreasing, whatever has been taken into the crankcase could also be pushed out. So this is a region which you do not want. This is the region which you want. But if you want to use the piston to open and close the port, you have to have both the regions. So this is another problem in the two-stroke engine. If you push this inlet opening earlier and earlier, if you move this earlier and earlier, the inlet closing also will move later and later. So whatever you have taken in may be pushed out through the crankcase itself. So this is another problem in the two-stroke engine. So we see number of problems in the two-stroke engine, all because of the fact that piston is used to open and close the ports. And piston only is used to open and close the ports because it is the simplest way of doing things. So in a small two-stroke engine, because the piston is used to open and close the intake ports, we run into several problems. The first problem being that you are not able to close the exhaust port before the transfer port. The second problem is that you are not able to open the inlet port very early and then close the inlet port early. If you open the inlet port at some angle, you are also closing the inlet port at the same angle. This again becomes another problem. So these problems are there. And what I want to say here is that one of the problems, another problem with the two-stroke engine is high noise. If you just observe, if there is a two-stroke engine without a silencer, it makes much more noise than a four-stroke engine without a silencer. It even makes much more noise than a tractor engine without a silencer. The reason is, when the two-stroke engine opens its exhaust port, the pressure in the cylinder is fairly high. This is what we saw here. When the exhaust port is opened, the pressure in the cylinder in a two-stroke engine is fairly high. Because you are opening the exhaust port fairly early, you are not opening at bottom dead center, you are opening it much before bottom dead center. So the pressure is very high. So when the exhaust port is opened, the hot gases inside the cylinder, which are at high pressure, just rush out, and it's almost like a small explosion. So pressure is about 5 bar, and at that time you simply open the exhaust port, so it just expands into the atmosphere and makes a lot of noise. So another problem in the two-stroke engine is high noise, and that occurs just because you open the exhaust port too early and you are forced to open it, otherwise the engine will not run properly. So this is another problem in the two-stroke engine. So there are several problems which you have seen: short circuiting, charge dilution, noise, not being able to take a lot of charge inside the cylinder. These are some of the important problems of the two-stroke engine. But still the two-stroke engine is popular because it is simple. That's the only reason. Now there are different methods by which one can admit the charge into a two-stroke engine. One method is called the rotary valve method. Now in the rotary valve method, you use a valve which is something like this. It is a disc shaped valve with a slot, something like this. You have a disc which is shaped like this, and this disc is actually something like this. I am drawing the other view of the disc. The slot is here. The slot is here. This is the full portion, and this is the axis about which the disc is rotating. This disc is attached at this point. This is this point where the disc is attached. So the disc is attached to the crankshaft, and the disc is running along with the crankshaft. and on the side of this disc you have a casing, and here there is a hole and there is another hole here. So as this disc runs, the hole on this casing and the hole in the disc will match only at some point, and they will match for some angle theta. So during this angle the atmosphere is connected to the crankcase. So this means that when the slot in the disc and when the hole in the crankcase, they all match, air can come from the atmosphere into the crankcase, and then when they don't match, the air will be sealed inside the crankcase. Now this is a step beyond what we saw earlier. In the previous case, what we saw was when the piston was moving up, it opened the ports and closed the ports. Here we are not using the piston to open and close the ports. You can see here that the carburetor is connected to the disc, is connected to the crankcase through the disc. So whenever this slot in the disc and the crankcase, they all match, fresh air from the atmosphere can draw fuel from the carburetor and get into the crankcase. Now the advantage here is that you can open and close the disc anywhere with respect to the piston. In the case of a piston control port, if you open the port at some position before top dead center, you will also close the port at the same position after top dead center. Do you get this point? If you open it at x degrees before top dead center, you will also close it at x degrees after top dead center. Whereas in this case, it's not required. You can open the port at bottom dead center and close it at top dead center, or you can open it at top dead center and close it at bottom center. The disc can be arranged in such a way that the opening and closing of the disc can be at whatever point you want. So this is a step above the piston control port, and which means that you have complete control over the charge induction to the crankcase, which we'll see later. So this is one step. The next arrangement is what is called as a reed valve. The reed valve is the most popular. This is the reed valve, and reed valve is actually a one-way valve. It's a one-way valve. It allows the charge in this direction, but it does not allow the charge in this direction. It's a one-way valve. So as the piston moves up, whenever the pressure in the crankcase is low, air will run from the atmosphere through the carburetor into the crankcase. Whenever the pressure in the cylinder crankcase becomes high, air will stop. So this is a one-way valve. It's operated by pressure differences. The pressure difference across the valve actually opens and closes the valve. When the pressure here, this is P1 and this is P2. When P1 is less than P2, the valve is open. And when P1 is greater than P2, the valve is closed. So when the piston moves up, the pressure P1 becomes less than the atmospheric pressure. So fresh air gets into the crankcase. When the piston moves down, the pressure in the crankcase becomes higher and no air goes out. So you find that it is a one-way valve. The advantage of this system is that irrespective of engine operation, whenever there is a low pressure in the crankcase, fresh charge will get into the crankcase. Whenever the pressure in the crankcase becomes high, fresh charge will not go out. It will just stop. So the opening and closing of the ports are now completely flexible. They are not fixed. So we now saw three systems for charging. One is the piston control port, the second one was a rotary valve, and the third one was the reed valve. Now we will compare these three. I'll come back to this. So these are the port timing diagrams of these three systems. Now if you look at the first figure, figure A, on the top left, you see that it's for a piston control port, which we have already seen. As the piston moves up, the inlet valve, inlet port opens here and the inlet port closes here. This is what we have already seen, and there are equal angles. Whenever the inlet port opens, at the same crank angle it closes also. And we saw that this is a problem, because during this portion the fresh air will get inside, and during this portion the fresh air may tend to go out of the crankcase, which is a disadvantage. And if you tend to push this down, you will also be tending to push this down, which is a disadvantage. Now on the other hand, I told you with the disc valve you have complete flexibility. If you look at the disc valve opens somewhere here and it closes somewhere here. It is not symmetrical. So the opening and closing of the disc valve are now not like the opening and closing of the piston ported engine. So as the piston moves up, somewhere after bottom dead center itself the disc valve opens, and as the piston is moving up, it continues to be open and it closes very close to top dead center, that is somewhat like this. So at this point you find that the fresh air is about to go out, and when it is about to go out, the disc valve closes. So the disc valve has unsymmetrical timing. So the difference between the piston control port and the disc valve is that the disc valve is unsymmetric. It is also fixed, but it is unsymmetric. Now the third thing is the reed valve. If you look at the reed valve, The reed valve, I told you, opens whenever the pressure in the crankcase is low, and it will close whenever the pressure in the crankcase is high. So as the piston moves up, if the engine is running at, let us say, low speed, this is figure C, the reed valve opens somewhere here and the reed valve closes somewhere here. So as the piston went up, the pressure in the crankcase went down, somewhere the reed valve opened, fresh charge started entering, piston went up and the piston comes down, and the pressure in the crankcase increases, the reed valve closes. So this entire period is the intake period. So you are able to increase the intake period with the reed valve as compared to the piston ported engine. So you have more time for the fresh charge to get inside, you can take more air into the engine. This is one advantage. Secondly, you see, when the speed changes, the reed valve adjusts itself. When the speed becomes higher, you find that the reed valve's opening point went up to this point and closing point remains somewhere here. So it always works with pressure difference, so it never allows the charge to go out, and it allows the charge only to get into the cylinder. So we see that reed valve is flexible and it changes itself with speed. That is the biggest advantage. The disc valve is not flexible, but it is not symmetrical, so it has an advantage. The disc valve is not symmetrical, that is an advantage, but it is not variable, it is fixed. Once you make the disc, the same timing comes. But piston control port is not flexible and it is not also unsymmetric. It is symmetric and inflexible. So that is the least desired one. But this is the easiest to make. So many small engines still use the piston control port. Most of the automotive engines make use of either the reed valve or the rotary valve. So now the tendency is only to use a reed valve or rotary valve. And amongst this reed valve and rotary valve, the reed valve is still preferred because it is also flexible. So that is what you see from all the port timing diagrams here. Now we look at, now we saw what happened at the bottom of the cylinder. Now we are going to the top of the cylinder. Now we look at the different methods by which one can scavenge the two-stroke engine, or one can remove the exhaust and push the fresh charge into the cylinder. So you are seeing different kinds of scavenging methods here. The first scavenging method, as you see in figure A, is what we call as a cross scavenging method. So this is called cross. Now the cross scavenging method is called cross scavenging just because the exhaust port, this is the exhaust port and this is the transfer port. The exhaust port and the transfer port are facing each other. So we call it a cross scavenging arrangement. So the charge is actually going across the cylinder. And you find here that the piston has a deflector. The piston has a deflector. That is because the fresh charge which comes inside is pushed by the piston to the roof of the cylinder, and so that it can make a loop and it will not go directly from here to here. We don't want the fresh charge to directly go from the inlet port to the exhaust port, so the piston stop acts as a deflector. This system is very simple to make. Very simple to make just because the ports are facing each other. So when you manufacture, you can machine one of the ports, and through this port you can machine the other port. So it's very simple to manufacture, and that is why it was very popular. But now it is not very popular. The reason being that in spite of having a deflector, some of the fresh charge will directly go into the exhaust. So this system leads to scavenging efficiency which is very low. There is a low scavenging efficiency, and trapping efficiency is also low. That is, you will lose charge directly through the exhaust, which means trapping efficiency is low. You may also retain a lot of fresh charge, lot of exhaust, which means that scavenging efficiency is low. So this system invariably leads to low efficiencies, and it is given up almost. There are some applications where it is still used. The one which is very popular is what we see in figure C, and we call this as the loop scavenging method. The loop scavenging method is the one which you see in figure C. And here, if you look at the, I think you also have to look at the plan and the elevation together, then only the loop scavenging is easy to understand. In the loop scavenging arrangement, the plan view shows there is port 1 here and a symmetric port 2 on the other side, then there is port 3 here and a symmetric port 4 on the other side. So in this case you have 4 inlet ports. All these 4 inlet ports connect to the crankcase. So fresh charge comes from the crankcase through these 4 ports, and 1 and 2 are opposite each other, 3 and 4 are opposite each other. So if you see that 1 and 2 are directed towards this point, 3 and 4 are also directed towards this point on the plan view. On the elevation, almost all of them are directed towards this point. So the ports are oriented in such a way that horizontally they are directed at some point, and at an angle also directed at some point. So all of them meet at this point. So the jets of air which come from different ports all meet at some point here, and they form a loop. So there is a loop of fresh charge which goes out. In fact, you can see that the fresh charge is directed away from the exhaust port. The exhaust port is here. The exhaust port is here, and the fresh charge is actually pushed in a direction which is opposite the exhaust port. So this fresh charge now will not directly go into the exhaust because it is directed on the other side. So these are highly directed ports, and the piston is not doing any work here. The piston is not deflecting the charge. It is the ports that are deflecting the charge. The ports are oriented. So these are oriented ports. So they are difficult to make, but they are quite efficient. And this is called as loop scavenging. In loop scavenging, there can be different methods, but I wish to just stick on to this one. So this is the second method, which is loop scavenging. This is the first method, which is cross scavenging. And it is a loop scavenging method that is very popular. In fact, all moped engines, all two-stroke scooter engines, all of them are loop scavenging, and they all are like this. Sometimes in loop scavenging, you can have even more than four ports. There can be six ports, eight ports, all of them inlet, but all of them doing the job of creating a loop inside the cylinder and not depending on the piston for creating the deflection. So these are called as, these have actually flat pistons. So from the piston point of view, this is simpler. From the piston point of view, the cross scavenging engine has a complex piston. It has a deflector on top. The third method of scavenging, which you see here, is called the uniflow scavenging. The uniflow scavenging method is what you see in the third figure, that is D as well as E, and these are done on large engines. These are not seen on small engines. These are typically for large marine engines where you have valves. So on the top you see that there are two valves, and both of them in this case are exhaust valves, two exhaust valves or even four exhaust valves on the top, and at the bottom you see the piston and the ports around the piston. So fresh charge, the piston controls the inlet ports, and the exhaust is controlled by the exhaust valve. So these are exhaust valves and these are inlet ports. So as the piston moves down, the piston controls the inlet port, and the exhaust valve is driven by a cam, and that is controlled separately. So here what you do is, as the piston is going down, somewhere at some point the exhaust valve opens and the exhaust, hot exhaust, rushes out, and after some time the piston opens the inlet port and fresh charge comes from the bottom. So the main advantage here is that the fresh charge comes like this and the exhaust goes like this. So both the fresh charge and the exhaust are going in the same direction. That is why we call it uniflow scavenging. It is like having a tube and filling the tube from one end and emptying it from the other end. So you find that the fresh charge and the exhaust will not mix significantly. So you are able to almost drive all the exhaust out and retain fresh charge as much as possible. But these kinds of engines make use of a blower. And what is sent here is actually air. And these are normally used for compression ignition engines. They are not used for spark ignition engines. So these are large marine diesel engines where you have a blower which takes in air from the atmosphere and pushes through the bottom ports, and through the top you have an exhaust which is pushing the exhaust out, which is opening out and letting the exhaust out. So these are for large marine engines, and this is called uniflow scavenging, and this gives the highest scavenging efficiency. The scavenging efficiency is extremely high here. The scavenging efficiency is very low in cross, and the scavenging efficiency of loop is somewhere in between. So you have three kinds of machines, and the loop is very, very common in the case of SI engines, and uniflow is very common in the case of CI engines. This is for CI engines. That's what we see here. This uniflow can also be obtained by making use of what is called an opposed cylinder arrangement, which we'll see very soon. I'll show it here. This is the uniflow scavenging with an opposed cylinder arrangement, where you see two crankshafts. Both the crankshafts are geared and connected together, and both these crankshafts operate two pistons, and the two pistons are running on the same cylinder. We call it an opposed piston engine, and one of the pistons is opening the inlet port, the other piston is opening the exhaust port. So you once again here also you see what is called as uniflow scavenging, but these are all not possible in small engines. These are typically for very, very large engines. Sometimes they take each one of these shafts and make them drive different, maybe one of the shafts driving one propeller and the other shaft driving another propeller. So all this is possible. It's also possible to see to it that both these pistons do not reach their top dead centers together. There can be a small phase shift. So one reaches top dead center first, then the other one comes. So with a phase difference, they move. So what I show on the top is a port timing diagram. This is top dead center. This is bottom dead center. And the crankshaft is rotating, and the piston is moving from top dead center to bottom dead center in this direction. At top dead center, almost at top dead center, there was combustion. And as the piston moves down, somewhere at this point, the exhaust port opens. And from here to here, when the piston is moving from top dead center to bottom dead center, the pressure in the cylinder is high, and it is gradually coming down, like in a four-stroke engine. Somewhere at this point, the exhaust port opens, so the pressure suddenly starts falling. And till the transfer port opens, the pressure suddenly falls, and this is what we called as blowdown, which is what you see here. So that is what I drew earlier. And after the blowdown process, the piston continues to move to bottom dead center, and in this portion the pressure very slowly falls in the cylinder, and once again you start compressing from bottom dead center, but compression cannot occur here because the transfer port is, the exhaust port is open, and compression can actually start only from here, and it is here that the pressure actually starts raising. So this is how the two-stroke engine's PV diagram looks. Otherwise on this side, the two-stroke engine's PV diagram is very similar to the four-stroke engine's PV diagram. There's no difference on this side. But on the right hand side, there's a lot of difference because of the ports opening and closing. And at this point, the pressure can be about 4 bar also. And this is the one which leads to noise. This is how we summarize. Next, I want to tell you something about how the performance of a two-stroke engine can be improved. Now, one of the problems which you saw here was that the exhaust port opens before the transfer port. And in this process, there is blowdown. And because you open the exhaust port before the transfer port, you are also forced to close the exhaust port after the transfer port. And in this period, whatever you took into the cylinder can go out. Are you able to imagine that in this period, whatever we took into the cylinder can go out of the cylinder? Piston is moving from bottom dead center to top dead center, but the exhaust port is open. So whatever was in the cylinder can be pushed out. And if you do not want it to be pushed out, you should close the exhaust port early. But if you close the exhaust port early, you will also open it late. So that's not possible. So we would like to do something outside the engine to prevent this from happening. That is, what we exactly want is, we want to open the exhaust port first, then the transfer port. But we want to close the exhaust port first and then only close the transfer port. Or we want to close the exhaust port and the transfer port simultaneously at the as early as possible, which is not possible in a conventional engine. Now this we can do in a tuned exhaust pipe. In a tuned exhaust pipe, what we do is, if this is the exhaust port and we have an exhaust pipe which is like this. We connect this kind of a pipe to the exhaust of the engine, and we see how this can make these changes. Now what really happens is, when the exhaust port opens, I told you that the pressure is much above atmospheric pressure. So let us say the pressure is something like 4 bar. So at this point, when the exhaust port, when the piston was somewhere here, and the piston was moving down, the pressure in the cylinder was 4 bar. And when the piston just opened this point, that 4 bar pressure appeared in the exhaust pipe. So the exhaust pipe was suddenly disturbed, and at this point the pressure went to 4 bar. Is this clear? Just before the exhaust port opens, the pressure in this exhaust pipe was atmospheric. Just when the exhaust port opens, the pressure suddenly went to 4 bar. So it is like exposing this point to a small explosion. That is, the pressure suddenly was raised there. Now what happens is, this small raise in pressure sends out pressure waves. Pressure waves start traveling from the inlet to the exhaust side, and they travel at sonic speed. So the pressure waves start moving at sonic speed, and whenever there is a change in dimension, whenever there is a change in area, the pressure wave gets reflected. So the pressure wave gets reflected. Actually, as the pressure wave goes here, there is a sudden raise in the area. That means the pressure suddenly drops there. the pressure suddenly drops there, there's a disturbance created, and that disturbance also travels. So what the point to note here is that as the pressure wave travels, if there is a sudden change in area, that sudden change in area creates another pressure difference, and that pressure difference also starts traveling. And if there's a sudden reduction in area, the pressure suddenly raises. If there's a sudden enlargement in area, the pressure suddenly falls. So you should see here that as this pressure wave travels up to the point A, or for example, even if I'll call this as A, I'm going to change this to B. When the pressure wave goes up to A, at A, there's a sudden enlargement. So at A, there's a sudden drop in pressure. And at A, you send out a wave which goes backwards, also forwards. So you create a disturbance at A, and that disturbance is a pressure which is dropping, and it travels both forwards and backwards. The backward wave comes back to the engine. Do you see this? The backward wave comes back to the engine. The forward wave is traveling away from the engine. So this forward wave continues to go once again, and somewhere here there is a sudden contraction. There is a sudden contraction here at C, there is a sudden contraction here at D. So these contractions at C and D, this contraction particularly at C, and there is a sudden change at D, these also send out pressure waves. So these pressure waves also start traveling backward. So you see that there is a series of pressure waves traveling backwards, all initiated by the first pressure wave. So when the exhaust port opened, there was a first pressure wave which started traveling out of the engine, and that pressure wave created some disturbances, and those disturbances started traveling back into the engine. And if you very clearly see, the first pressure wave which comes back into the engine is a low pressure wave because it came from the expansion. The second pressure wave which came was from the contraction, it's a high pressure wave. So now the point to note here is that in the exhaust port, first a pressure wave traveled, and the first pressure wave to come back to the exhaust port was a rarefaction wave. That means it was a pressure wave which decreased its amplitude because it came from the enlargement. The second pressure wave which came to the exhaust port was a compression wave, because it came from the point C. So you have two waves coming back to the engine. The first wave is a rarefaction wave, the second wave is a compression wave. Now we'll see what this rarefaction wave will do and what this compression wave will do. What's a rarefaction wave? It's a wave which will bring down the pressure, because the pressure has gone down there. A compression wave will raise the pressure. So now let us imagine the whole sequence of things. I'll put the port timing diagram once again. This is the point where the exhaust port opened. This is the point where the transfer port opened. And symmetrically here, transfer port closes and the exhaust port closes. We didn't want the exhaust port to close very late. We are trying to avoid this by doing something in the exhaust. So the exhaust port opened here, sent out a wave, and after some time when you reach bottom dead center, the pressure in the cylinder has fallen down. Now there is the rarefaction wave which comes first. That is, the rarefaction wave comes to this point. That means a low pressure comes to the exhaust port. If a low pressure comes to the exhaust port, can I say that it will suck the exhaust out? If a low pressure wave comes to the exhaust port, that means the pressure in the exhaust port is below atmospheric. So the exhaust will be sucked from the cylinder, and it is beneficial because exhaust was initially flowing because of pressure difference, then it is not flowing. So this negative wave will, this rarefaction wave will pull the exhaust out. So it will remove all the exhaust properly. But if it continues for a long time, fresh charge also will come out. By that time what happens is compression wave comes behind it. The compression wave comes behind it and arrives at some point somewhere here. So at this point, the compression wave comes, and somewhere here the rarefaction wave comes. So when the piston is almost at bottom dead center, the rarefaction wave comes and pulls the exhaust out, and after some time the compression wave from point C and D comes again and then plugs the exhaust. That means even though the exhaust port is open here, nothing will flow from the engine out because you put a high pressure at that point. And when these waves will return back depends on how much time they take. Is this clear? And how much time they take will depend on all these lengths. This length L1 and this length L2. So this sonic wave will travel from this point to A, get reflected and come back. That will come back as rarefaction wave. It will come back quickly because the length L1 is small. After some time, from the length L2, you will get a compression wave. That will come back late. So the first rarefaction wave will pull the exhaust out. The second compression wave will plug the exhaust. So even though the exhaust port is closing after the transfer port, the plugging of the exhaust occurs and nothing will flow out of the exhaust. It's as good as blocking the exhaust. But the exhaust was open, but you blocked it with the high pressure. So by tuning the exhaust pipe, you will be able to bring these waves at the right point and improve the performance of the engine. Now, how do we tune is by changing the lengths L1 and L2. You want the exhaust pressure waves to come at the right time. So if that is what racing motorcycles, when they tune a racing motorcycle, a two-stroke motorcycle, this is what they do. They play with the exhaust pipe. They put a new exhaust pipe and all that. What they do is actually this. They tune all these lengths so that they get the pressures at the right point. Unfortunately, there is a problem here. It will work well at one engine speed, it will not work well at the other engine speed, because all the waves have to come at the right time. They will come at the right time for one speed. At another speed, they won't come at the right time. So this tuning is done only for one speed. It doesn't work over a range of speeds. So I wanted to only tell that by tuning the exhaust pipe, we can improve the performance of a two-stroke engine. And you can get over some of the problems that you have because the exhaust port and transfer ports are closed late. And they are closed late because the piston is opening and closing the exhaust port and transfer port. This is what we see here. And I just wanted to finally put this performance curve and then look at how we can improve the two-stroke engine. Now, this performance is a typical performance curve. On the x-axis, you see the air-fuel ratio. I told you that the chemically correct air-fuel ratio is around 14.5:1. So you can see here that we are using mixtures which are less than 14.5:1, that is rich mixture. So this is rich and this is lean. So we have rich and lean, and somewhere here we have the chemically correct mixture. So we have gone on both sides. Now, if you recollect what I told you earlier, in the two-stroke engine you have two main problems. One is short circuiting and the other one is charge dilution. Now we would like to know when the problem of short circuiting will be very high and when the problem of charge dilution will be very high. When do you think the problem of short circuiting will be very high? We will look at this from the point of view of opening the throttle. We will imagine a two-stroke engine is running at some constant speed and we are simply opening the throttle. And as we open the throttle, what we are doing is allowing more and more charge into the cylinder. That means what we are changing is the delivery ratio or the volumetric efficiency. When I open the throttle, I am changing the delivery ratio. Now, we will now compare two operating conditions. One is fully open throttle and the other one is partly open throttle. So, I call full throttle and part throttle, FT and PT. FT is full throttle, PT is part throttle. Now, let us take a condition where we put it at FT. If I put it at FT, I am sending maximum amount of charge into the cylinder. Now, will you have charge dilution problem or you won't have? If I send lot of charge into the cylinder, do you think I will have charge dilution problem? When I send lot of fresh charge into the cylinder, will I retain lot of exhaust? Charge dilution is because of exhaust that is retained. So if I send lot of fresh charge into the cylinder, I will not retain lot of exhaust. So charge dilution will be less. So when the delivery ratio is high, charge dilution will be low. If charge dilution is low, can I say combustion will be good? There is no exhaust inside the cylinder, so combustion will be good. So in a two-stroke engine, at full throttle, there will be no charge dilution and combustion will be good. So this is one aspect to see. At part throttle, you are sending very small amount of charge into the cylinder, and that small amount of charge into the cylinder will not push all the exhaust out. So there will be a lot of exhaust in the cylinder and you will find that your dilution will be very high. So at part throttle, combustion will not be good in a two-stroke engine. Can I say that? Full throttle combustion will be good, part throttle combustion will not be good. Full throttle no charge dilution, part throttle heavy charge dilution. So at part throttle, what kind of mixture should you use to run the engine if there is too much of charge dilution? too much of sun, that is lot of dilution with exhaust, a very lean mixture may not burn. So you will be forced to use a rich mixture. So in a two-stroke engine, at part throttle, you will be forced to use a rich mixture because of charge dilution. On the other hand, at full throttle, you don't need a rich mixture because there is no charge dilution. But at full throttle, I'll tell you there is another problem. There will be a problem of overheating. Why should an engine overheat at full throttle? At full throttle, its cooling is not proper. At full throttle, what happens is you are trying to generate maximum power from the engine. That means you are trying to burn a lot of fuel. When you try to burn a lot of fuel, the temperature of the components will naturally go up because you have to dissipate a lot of heat. And to dissipate a lot of heat, the temperature of the components will go up. So you find that at full throttle, one of the main problems is overheating of the engine. Now, how do you cool the engine? Maybe you use air or water or whatever to cool the engine. But with all this also, the engine will overheat. And what happens if the engine overheats? It fails. You will have loss of lubrication, you will have knocking and all that. So in a two-stroke engine, you normally have problems of overheating at full throttle. It is more than a four-stroke engine. Why is it more than a four-stroke engine? A two-stroke engine develops double the power of a four-stroke engine for the same size. So for the same size, it is developing double power, means it will also generate more heat in unit time. So it has to dissipate more heat, so it goes to higher temperatures. So the problem at full throttle is overheating. It is not charge dilution. And how to prevent overheating? Whatever cooling you do from outside, it is not enough. So you do cooling from inside. And how do you do cooling from inside?
Lubrication.
One is lubrication. The other one is using a rich mixture. So can I say that if you use a rich mixture, the temperature of the charge will be low? If I use a rich mixture, the temperature of the charge is low. I just make a statement. Does it appeal to you? When you add fuel to air, can I say that when fuel vaporizes in air, the temperature of air will come down because it has to take its latent heat? So if you use a rich mixture, you are putting more fuel into the same amount of air, so the charge temperature will go down. So one of the ways of cooling an engine by internally cooling the engine is by using a rich mixture. So you find even motorcycle engines, even four-stroke motorcycle engines, when you go to full throttle, they use a rich mixture. It is not because of combustion, it is just because of overheating. Otherwise the engine will fail. So in a two-stroke engine is a severe problem. So at full throttle, you will use a rich mixture. So mixture at full throttle will be rich, and this is used for preventing overheating. Mixture at part throttle will be rich, and this will be used to prevent bad combustion because of dilution. Charge dilution occurs at part throttle, and if you want the combustion to occur even in a diluted charge, you need to use a rich mixture. So what does it mean? In a two-stroke engine, you will normally tend to use a rich mixture. Be it part throttle or full throttle, you want to use a rich mixture, otherwise you will not be able to sustain combustion properly. Full throttle for overheating, preventing overheating, part throttle to sustain combustion. So this is one very important thing in a two-stroke engine. So mixture will be richer than a four-stroke engine. Now if you look at the problem of short circuiting, which is the other problem in the two-stroke engine, at part throttle, we don't have the problem of short circuiting. We are sending in a small amount of charge, and that charge does not go out, it stays inside. So at part throttle, we don't have short circuiting. At full throttle, we send a large amount of charge, so there can be short circuiting. So now we look at the implications of short circuiting and charge dilution on performance. Now if there is short circuiting, it means that you are losing fresh charge. Fresh charge is going out. So short circuiting will directly lead to hydrocarbon emissions. Can I say this? Whatever, if there is short circuiting, fresh charge is going out of the exhaust, and if fresh charge goes out of the exhaust, fuel is going out of the exhaust, so hydrocarbon emissions will be high. So in a two-stroke engine, because of short circuiting, HC levels will go up, and HC levels will be high at full throttle because of short circuiting. This is one point. Now the second thing is, if the combustion is not good, if the combustion is not good, what do you mean by combustion not being good? That means some of the fuel inside the cylinder will not burn. So then also hydrocarbons will be very high. So in a two-stroke engine, at part throttle also hydrocarbon emissions will be high. But at part throttle, they'll be high because of charge dilution. At full throttle, HC will be high because of short circuiting. So HC in a two-stroke engine will generally be high. At full throttle, the HC is because of short circuiting. At part throttle, it is because of dilution. So that's what you see here on the right hand side. On the right hand side, you see here that at full throttle, the hydrocarbon levels are very high, and this is just because of short circuiting and rich mixtures. So you use rich mixtures, you also have a lot of short circuiting. So the net result is that hydrocarbon levels in a two-stroke engine at full throttle are very high. They can be something like even 5 to 10 times higher than a four-stroke engine, because simply fuel is going out of the engine. Whatever you send is being short circuited. On the other hand, at part throttle, you find that the HC emissions are not so high. They are not so high because short circuiting is not a big problem. And at part throttle, hydrocarbon levels become high only when charge dilution becomes a problem. When does charge dilution become a problem? When the air fuel ratio becomes very, very lean. So as you go to the right, you find at part throttle the hydrocarbon levels are going up. The black line is for part throttle. So it went up because the mixture became very lean. So when the mixture becomes very lean, at part throttle you are not able to sustain combustion because there is a lot of exhaust inside the cylinder. Whereas in the case of full throttle, the hydrocarbon levels are always high just because of short circuiting. And when the mixture becomes lean, at full throttle you don't have any problems because full throttle there is no charge dilution. So this is what you see here. So on the whole, you find that at full throttle everywhere the hydrocarbon levels are high. At part throttle generally it is low, and at part throttle it shoots up only when the mixture becomes very lean, and when it becomes very lean you have the problem of dilution and misfiring. At full throttle you always have high HC levels just because of short circuiting and mixture being rich. So a two-stroke engine is bad from the point of view of hydrocarbons. When you come to the fuel consumption, which is shown on the left hand side, the fuel consumption is also related to short circuiting. If fuel is directly beating short circuiting, fuel consumption will be high. So you find that at full throttle, which is this line, the fuel consumption is high all the time, and it is high just because of short circuiting. At part throttle, it is low because short circuiting is not very high. It becomes high when the mixture becomes very lean because combustion becomes bad. Firing is not good. So you have irregular combustion. So in general, you can say that full throttle performance of a two-stroke engine is inferior to part throttle performance because you have a lot of short circuiting. And when you go to very, very low levels of throttle, you have problem of charge dilution and misfiring. So hydrocarbon levels are dominated by short circuiting. Hydrocarbon levels are also dominated by dilution. And dilution at part throttle and short circuiting at full throttle. This is what you see here. So if you want to improve a two-stroke engine, all that we need to do is prevent short circuiting and prevent dilution. Both have to be done, which is very, very difficult. So I'm just going to tell you one solution and stop with that and go to the next title. Now one solution to prevent this is to inject the fuel. That is, you inject the fuel into the cylinder. Now if you can make an engine, two-stroke engine, where during the compression process you don't take any fuel at all, you only take air, do the scavenging, and then during the compression process when the ports are closed, afterwards you put the fuel into the cylinder, then you don't lose any fuel, then short circuiting is completely avoided. So the best way to prevent short circuiting in a two-stroke engine is to directly inject the fuel. Inject the fuel after the ports close. So you simply put the fuel into the cylinder after all the ports close, then you don't lose any charge, and then there is no short circuiting. And if there is no short circuiting, your hydrocarbon levels will come down, fuel consumption also will come down. These two are the benefits. But putting the fuel into the cylinder is not an easy thing because it calls for a very complicated system, as we'll see in the next lecture. Now the other problem is dilution. Dilution cannot be avoided by injection, because dilution is because of exhaust being retained. So if you want to prevent dilution, you have to push the exhaust properly out, and that depends only on how well you have designed the ports. So port design, that is how well you have designed, prevents dilution. So if you design the ports well in a two-stroke engine, do the scavenging process properly, don't push all the exhaust out properly, then you will be able to get good performance at diluted conditions, that means part throttle. If you inject the fuel into the cylinder, you will get good performance at full throttle. So this is how we can improve a two-stroke engine. So So I wish to stop at this point for the two-stroke engine. So if you have any questions, you can ask me, and then I'll go to the next one.